humble. We use our humility, you know, being kind, considerate, humble, in order to manipulate others so that they do what we want them to do. That's what we use it for, in general. And one needs to, you see, being humble is a good thing. But when you get upset when the other then is not humble and takes whatever you didn't want them to take, if you get upset, that is not real humility. Yeah. So, but one still thinks that one is kind of humble. So that's what I mean. So, don't worry. There's every nation has a national delusion. So, it's okay. So like that. So we have moments when we're really spacious, and then we should start to think, well, that's the nature of our mind when we feel really well. So I need a bit of affirmation here. Do you know what I'm talking about, or is that totally foreign? Yeah? Some still don't know. Shall I let you go to bed, or? Yeah, I mean, it's late, I know, it's 8:30. I know, it's really late. I'm sure you go to bed at 7 o'clock every night, isn't it? It's another thing that you need on your spiritual path is humor, to being able to laugh about yourself. If you take yourself terribly seriously and you come here and say, I want to become a good person and I want to be kind and this and that, you will fail also. Yeah, you might just increase your ego and your self-hatred or whatever. So let go, it's okay. I just read in a book the other day, it's like before in spiritual practice, before you do meditation, prayers, ritual, study, you have to learn to laugh about yourself at least once a day. Much more important. Much more important. Spiritual practice is about becoming insignificant, ordinary, and nobody. Oh, can they still go home? You see, the more we want to be special, the more we want to be somebody, the more problems we have, the more complicated we become. If you have the courage to be simple and just to be the way you are, really the way you are, not to attract attention, not because something special, just the way you are, life becomes very easy. The moment, you know, every time you meet somebody, you want to be at your best, you want to be right, you want to have what you want, life becomes really complicated. So it's about becoming simple, I'm afraid, but happy. You see, when you meet these masters, like what always strikes people, how normal they are. You know, somebody like the Dalai Lama, you think like, wow, you know, exotic or whatever, if you never met him, then you meet him and you go like, he's so normal. And you feel safe with somebody like this, because they have a lot of space, yeah? And they don't necessarily see you as special. So if you go there, this is what I see sometimes around the Dalai Lama. You see, people go forward and they want to be close to him and all this. Not because they want to see them, but he should see me, that I am here. Yeah. So then again, if we can just let go of that and think, wow, there's such a nice person still living on this planet, you know, who has undergone so much suffering, has lost his country, so many of his people got kind of tortured, hasn't got his country back, still holds on to this policy of non-violence, is in a good mood even though he hears like many, many difficult things every day. It's like, it's so inspiring. It's so inspiring. So we can let them touch. By the way, if Leora Price at the moment is reading the book of His Holiness Dalai Lama and Desmond Tutu. She can hardly put it down. I mean, it's in Hebrew, so I couldn't share it with her. So I really, especially with this topic, the open heart, I really recommend it to you, because both of them, like having people like this who have undergone so much suffering inflicted by others for seemingly like, you know, the Tibetans, they were in their country, they didn't invade anybody or whatever. Seemingly, no reason. Or Desmond Tutu also in South Africa, the black people and those, but can be I can have such a good heart and be so flexible and so spacious. I mean, that is something that we should aspire for. This is something that should let us touch us and think, like, if they can do it, how about me, who nobody has taken away, whatever. You know, how about me? I should also be able to do that. Yeah, and to go back there again and again and again, to go back to your own nature.
Also,
to be inspired.
Also, they both have wonderful sense of humor. And
yeah.
They have a good time there in the book. You read many jokes.
Yeah.
You laugh all the time.
Yeah.
It's fantastic.
Mm. Yeah. I watched some of it on YouTube when they were in Dharamsala. Like, as Laura says, they're laughing all the time. Because why? Because they don't take themselves seriously. But then when we hear this, we get afraid and we think, okay, then I just become a no good and I don't do good jobs and all this. I see these two people, they do very good jobs. They don't take themselves seriously, but they take the situation seriously. But they're not kind of identifying with it. And they try. And if they succeed, fine. If they don't succeed, then they let go. And go to something else. There's always something to do. You know, we don't have to kind of cling to one thing like this. If we see that we're stuck, we go to somewhere else. Yeah, and if you decide to work with your mind, I tell you, you can go on for a long time. You will always have something to do. Okay. So this title here, the open heart, I mean, it can also be said as the good heart. Loving kindness. What else? What else could it be, you know, described as?
Compassion.
I hope you're not going to be so silent the whole weekend. Because you see, because I'm not a good teacher, I need your help to kind of, to communicate with me. So this is usually what I do. I like to communicate with people a bit, because otherwise, you know, not just go, whatever, because I can't. Not just because I don't want to, it's because I can't. Okay. Good heart. What else would you call it? Good heart, loving kindness, open heart.
Compassion.
Compassion. Bodhicitta. Oh, where did that come from? Where did the bodhicitta come from? Okay, bodhicitta. Okay, we have a lot of new people. So for... That's the most noble heart, I think, is would be bodhicitta. And that is the goal, okay? This is when you are finishing this program, this is what you should kind of at least know intellectually. And then if you continue to really wish and want that. So thank you for thank you very much for that word. It's a mind or it's an intention to say, I want to free myself from all negative emotions, not just for my own happiness, but in order to be of real help or benefit to all others. Now, what is the best benefit that we can give others?
Love.
Understanding. Huh?
Understanding.
Understanding.
Be there.
Be there. Yeah? Being with them.
Free from suffering.
Free from suffering, exactly. To show them how one attains that state which one can be free from all negative emotions. Okay. So how about you? Do you have this confidence that you can free yourself from all disturbing emotions, or as we called them before, kleshas? A mind state that kind of makes you become very tight, very small, very narrow, very narrow. With these kleshas, your view becomes very narrow, because it's usually want this or doesn't want this, and other people not so important anymore. Yeah, one becomes very narrow, one doesn't have peace of mind, one is restless. And one is like a bulldog. You cannot let go kind of these thoughts. They come and haunt you again and again and again and again. These are kleshas. And when we see things through the filter of a klesha, we exaggerate in different ways. I think Glenn already talked about this quite a bit in the afternoons, didn't he? I didn't really watch all of it, but I saw that he was talking about attachment and anger and all this. So, but we'll talk about this again in on this weekend, because this is the work. To work with these negative emotions, but to work them with them in a skillful way, right? Yeah. So do you believe that you can liberate yourself from all these, from the negative emotions?
Something.
Huh?
Something.
So which ones do you want to keep? For the person who said some of them. Which ones do you want to get rid of, and which ones do you want to keep? Huh? Can you get rid of wrong views?
Sure.
Of course, by replacing it with right views. I mean, it's very easy, that one. Yeah, but problem is like we have habits, patterns. Our wrong views are very, very, very deep. So it's like when, you know, somebody has a view and this one is wrong, and you try to tell the person the right view. So first the person says, it's the same, you know. If I have a view, somebody says, hey, this is not true. What's up? What's my first reaction? You're wrong. I'm right. Then if I'm wise and I see that the view that I have is not very helpful and it doesn't really get me anywhere, so then when I'm wise, I start to question it. I start to have doubts if my view is really right or wrong, if you're wise. If you're not wise and you stick to your view but you still suffer, well, sorry, it's your fault. Yeah. Like, we keep on doing the same thing again and again and again and again, and we're hoping for a better result. I mean, come on. This is not really wise, is it? Here we start something new, or we try something new. So we have some doubts that maybe, is my view really right? Then when we start to look and we keep studying, then all of a sudden, because we have started to let the mind go in a different way and we make ourselves familiar with that different view, then it becomes equal, yeah? And then slowly, when we start to see that actually this other view is more helpful, then slowly the mind starts to change, and then the habit goes in that direction, yeah? See what I mean? So it's work. It doesn't happen by itself. Like the bodhicitta, the mind that wants to become fully awakened, like wake up from the dream of dualistic thinking, good and bad, okay? Ultimately, relatively, there are things are good and bad. Ultimately, not so, yeah? But we treat them as if it's ultimately good or bad. There's always a good thing to a bad thing. There's always a bad thing to a good thing. I mean, everything has two sides, yeah? But this is what we don't want to see. So if we start to kind of develop these views and then have this mind of I want to attain full awakening, even if we just go on that path and we still have like lots of negative emotions and all this, but all of a sudden we start to see, hey, if I react with an open heart, actually life becomes easier. But we're so afraid that other people are going to take advantage of us. If you have to work with somebody who has a good heart, who is patient, who when you make a mistake, they're not vomiting their whole frustration upon you. They're actually trying to help you, not for their own fame, but because not for their own advancing in the job or for higher salary, just because they have the skills and they see that you need help. Do you know people like this? Yeah. Everybody? Change your job. Go work somewhere else. Wow, it's horrible if you don't know anybody like this. Yeah, if you have to work in a workplace where everybody's just boycotting each other. Huh. Wow. Then you be the one to start. Yeah, then maybe people get inspired, but no, we are afraid. Others have to start because we are afraid that we're going to be taken advantage of, isn't it? And then we feel like the friar, yeah? So here in Israel, because it's such a big problem, this whole Friar syndrome. Yeah, it is. Like, everybody's so afraid to be taken advantage of the other. So be the good example and let other people take advantage of you. What's the big deal? So what? We also take advantage of others when we can, isn't it? We're also happy when we're not the Friar. Huh?
That's okay.
Yes or no?
Yes, but that's okay.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Then it's okay. Yeah, so... But how do you view somebody who has a good heart, what I just described, you know, in your work job? Would you like that person or do you dislike the person? Do you think that the person is being naive and stupid?
No.
No. So why are you afraid that other people will see you as naive and stupid? What's your fear? Examine that. Again, look inside. Examine that. Okay? Because what we're going to do this weekend is how to generate a good heart, an open heart, spacious heart. Okay? And it's very much part of the Buddhist path, this kindness. And kindness starts quite low down by making a conscious decision not to harm others voluntarily, meaning abiding by the 10 non-virtuous actions. So it's quite simple. So they're not commandments in Buddhism. They are recommendations. As it is said, if you do this, then this happens. If you do that, then that happens. Talking about karma, talking about our actions having consequences. Yeah. So that, you know, long-term, like short-term consequence, you can get away with something, but long-term consequence in terms of karmic results, you will not. Yeah, so whatever happens to us is a consequence of a past action that our mind stream did in the past. So this will definitely be one of the weekends when you talk about karma. You study and learn a lot about how the law of cause and effect, how that works. And then it's easier to have a good heart and to be open. Because one thing is you start to understand, now I can shape the future. What I did in the past is not much I can do except for purification. But now I can have some control over what will happen maybe in a future life. And so now I'm talking as if you are already Buddhist or if all of you believe in rebirth. I know that you don't, but this is Buddhism. So I need to give you the Buddhist view. So you from your side, if you do not believe in rebirth, I have no problem with this. I honor this, I respect this, I don't want to convince you that there is rebirth, but my job here is to give you Buddhism from A to Z, so I have to integrate rebirth, whether you like it or not. But you don't have to like it, just if you can't do anything with it, have the grace to just leave it aside. It's okay. Yeah? Is that okay? Yeah, I will maybe mention it a few times this weekend. Definitely when it comes to karma, when it comes to bodhicitta, then definitely it will be mentioned again and again and again and again. Yeah, it's just a view. I don't know if it's true. I don't know if there's rebirth, but I can see that if I kind of try to, in my daily actions, if I see that there's a klesha operating and I say stop and I wait until I've calmed down and then I act, I can see that my life becomes less complicated. Why? Because already now I don't have to have a bad conscience. Yeah? Because I don't want to be unkind. I am sometimes. I don't want to be angry. I am also sometimes. But I don't want it, I'm not proud of it, and then afterwards I can't sleep because I regret having said what I just said. And I can see that after these 25 years of practice, my anger has diminished a little bit, which is already quite a good thing, you know? Better a little bit than nothing or increased. At least it didn't increase, at least it kind of decreased, so that's already a good thing. So it takes long time. This is just what I wanted to say. So you need to have some patience and you need to want to do this. These 10 actions that we abstain from, you need to make a conscious decision. I want to become an ethical person. And not cook up all kinds of excuses to be unethical because it's expensive to be ethical or because it's not comfortable. Yeah. So also discipline is one of the practices that one needs to train in. And you can only train in discipline if you want to be disciplined. Yeah, but the thing is, because I also grew up in a belief system or in a religion where there's somebody looking and somebody telling you what you need to do, so then one can develop aversion towards that. Yeah. Here, it is not the Buddha who says you have to do this, but we hear that. Yeah, when we hear about the 10 non-virtuous actions, we hear, oh, the Buddha, phew, that one is also making rules. Who the heck he thinks he is? I want to be free. I want to do whatever I want to do. So becoming an ethical person is actually at the base of every spiritual practitioner. Otherwise, if you behave in an unethical way, meaning harming others, and you know you're harming them, and you don't care, I don't think you can call yourself a spiritual or even a religious person. You know, I don't think so. I think that is really... Then just... Anyway. You want to become ethical people? Also not so sure yet, okay? You can, you know, think about it. It's good that you're not just nodding when you're not sure. Have the courage to say, oh, not so sure, you know? We will, in this course of A to Z, we will give you all the advantages of being an ethical person, and then maybe at the end of these years, you will then think, yeah, I think it's a good thing to be an ethical person. And somebody has to start, so why not us? Yeah. So this is the thing. And having ethical conduct is actually a win-win situation. Because the people around you are happy, isn't it? And you will be happy if you decided to be it and you don't feel like the friar because your neighbor is not ethical. This is the problem. You see, when everybody around us is ethical, it's quite easy to be ethical. The moment somebody starts to be unethical, we feel stupid. Yeah. But in the long run, they get much more suffering. Yeah. But we can inspire, the same way as this unethical person inspires us to become unethical, we can inspire people by being ethical. Yeah. And in order to be ethical, you need what you trained with Glenn. Shamatha is like having awareness, being awake, seeing what's going on in your mind. Because otherwise, you see, we behave in a way which is unethical. We don't even notice. That is the problem. Yeah. So this is why the advantage, the first advantage of having awareness is becoming, having less fear of being found out, because you can, you know, you can lay bare whatever you did. There's absolutely no problem. And because of that, having a more spacious and happier mind. Yeah. So it's not so much just the mind who is concentrated and calm. What brings happiness is because you see your mind and because you're able to say stop when you feel a klesha arising. Yeah, this is why shamatha is so important. Calm abiding is so important. Yeah, because it enables or allows you to make the first step as a spiritual practitioner, which is to be a non-harming person. Then you can start with the good heart. But otherwise, you know, like harming others and wanting to have a good heart, you make your mind even more confused. Yeah. Do you feel sometimes that our mind is really confused? And it can very well come from the fact that up here we have decided to be an ethical person. But then all the fears come in and all the insecurities and all this and the habits and the patterns, and then we behave in a different way and we make zero effort to go the other way. So then of course we are confused. Yeah. On one hand we want to be honest and generous and what else? Like, you know, not hurting or not harming others. But then on the other hand, we don't practice the discipline to abstain from these actions. But as I said in the reflection, you have to be very gentle with yourself, yeah, and you have to understand how the mind works. You have to, you have to, no, you don't have to do anything, but it's good to be able not to identify with these negative emotions, because otherwise you start to judge yourself, and then again you're totally fixed on something. It's this, what one tries to do with study and meditation is to let go of that fixation of like real me, real other, real this, real that. Yeah, so this is what you're trying to do. Here's a text that I've already read it a few times, so some of you know it, and the text is called Without Love. So without love, some of the so-called good things can become negative. So I'll read it out again, and I think I forgot to send it to Irit, yeah? I think I haven't, yeah, I forgot. Huh? No, to Irit, to the group in Absol. So I just remembered, but I have good excuse. I had so little time in Tel Aviv and so much to do, and I forgot. Okay, so duty without love makes you grumpy. If it's your duty to do something, but here love is not just, love is kind of, because what I missed a little bit with the love when you described it, I missed openness, I missed spaciousness, I missed flexibility, joy, happiness. This is what I missed a little bit. You came up with all the right things, compassion, this and that, but like, you know, the good thing that comes with love is like, yeah, being flexible, not unneedy. If you have real love in your heart, you become a total non-nutnik. Wouldn't that be great? No needy, no more need for yourself. You just, everything flows. Yeah, this is the advantage of love. If you do duty and there is no love, that you don't love what you're doing, you become grumpy and you feel exploited. Yeah, and very quickly you lose your joy. Responsibility without love makes you ruthless. This is my responsibility, therefore I can do whatever I want. Maybe you recognize something in this, yeah? Justice without love makes you hard, you know? Kind of clean, self-righteous. I am right, I am just, I am just. Truth. Now, again, don't forget, duty, responsibility, justice, very good things. But you have to bring love into it, an open heart. Spaciousness, where you see, like with the justice, where you see all sides, not just one side. Truth, without love, makes you being addicted to criticize. Yeah, for all those who don't have the truth. Education, without love, makes you dodgy. You exploit others. They become very cunning, very smart, kind of manipulating others with your education and intelligence. Like, this is another thing I find really sad in our world, that intelligence is put up so high. Like, I was talking to somebody today who is dyslexic. By now he's like 50 or 60 maybe. He's a wonderful person and he has so many abilities. You give him something to fix, he can fix it, absolutely no problem. He's always in he's good humor. He has an incredible mind to remember things, for example. He can't read well, and when he writes he makes mistakes. He's dyslexic. But he has so many other good qualities, and if somebody is not like this person, they get lost in our society because we think they're no good, because they can't read or write. So what, I mean, what's the big deal? And one is not really kind of looking after them to bring out the other qualities that they have somehow, yeah? And then they feel lost in school, and believe it themselves that they're no good. Yeah. So these people need to be, but when they overcome to see it as a hindrance, they become wonderful people. Much nicer than these intelligent guys who think that they're the, you know, the top of the world just because they're intelligent and they have a Nobel Prize. No, really. You know, being intelligent doesn't make you nor an ethical person nor a good person with a good heart. So if you're not so intelligent, don't worry, it's okay. Good heart is kind of accessible for everybody. Yeah. I feel really sad, you know, when some people say, oh, you know, they're not very interesting, they're not very intelligent. It's very cruel and very hard and very ruthless, very arrogant kind of thing. So what, you know? Whereas if you're not, if you don't have these qualities that are taxed very high in this world, you have to find other ways to be happy. And then you discover your inner values and your inner goodness. And then you're okay, even if nobody recognizes your qualities. Yeah, when I told this person today, I said, but wow, you're such a wonderful person. He said, no, I'm just ordinary. Yeah. He says, I see it as a gift, my dyslexia. If we could teach that, these children, already very small, you know, when they are dyslexic, that would be very nice. So education without love makes you dodgy, manipulate others. Friendliness without love makes you being hypocritical. Yeah? Order, this is me. Order without love makes you fussy. You know, like, oh, no, the cover has to be here, and not like this, but like this. You know, people are very orderly, like me. When I saw it, it helped me so much to let go, not be so bloody fussy, sorry. Not be so, you know, so kind of picky. Oh, it has to be here, and this has to be here, and this, and this. Much more, it's so, you know, order with love is so relaxed. If it's in order, fine. If it's not in order, I can put it in order. It's okay. Yeah. Before, I would always get upset when somebody upset my order. Now I just put it back into order, if it's necessary. If it's not, I let it go. Expertise without love makes you dogmatic, self-opinionated, and bossy. Expertise, intelligence, when you're very good at something. But again, it's good to be good at something. Now, don't think that you should stop being experts or something like that. But you need to bring love to the whole thing. Power without love makes you violent. Honor without love makes you arrogant. Possession, this is interesting, without love makes you stingy and miserly. And this is what my teacher used to say. He said, oh gosh, what a waste of money when rich people cannot even spend it for themselves, because very often it is like that. Or they spend heaps of money, but then there's no happiness because they only spend it for themselves, you know. But he saw that in rich people. He said, not only they cannot help others with all their money, they can't even spend it themselves. Yeah. So if you have possessions and it's filled, you know, that love is in it, wow, then you want to share, you want to give. Yeah. Then the more you have, the better. And the more you give, the more comes back. So, isn't that wonderful? Faith without love makes fanatic. So never fight with others over your belief system. If you believe it, it's your system, you find it is helpful for what you want to become. Here in Buddhism is a wise and a kind person. Yeah, wise, kind of knowing what brings happiness and what brings suffering, being able to abandon what brings suffering, being able to develop or enhance that which brings happiness, that's the wisdom. Seeing things as they are, meaning if they have come together by conditions, they are impermanent. If we don't recognize this, then they are totally non-satisfying, they're in the nature of suffering, as it is said. And then the most wise thing, that there's no separate I or me or self. All we are is a combination of body and mind that is flowing and changing moment by moment by moment by moment. The only thing that remains is the continuity. Same as a river. Yeah, a river, when you look at the river, it's never the same river, but we think it's the same river. Yeah, we project some kind of identity into there that is the river. So same as with our body and mind. You'll learn a lot about this also, probably from Kelsang Wama or from Glenn, definitely not from me. I just touch on it from time to time so you get reminded of it. Yeah. Okay, so kind of this is what we practice for. This is what we do. This is then if you know Buddhism from A to Z. If you do the whole program, you will know the path. I mean, I've done some of these programs in Switzerland. I had people who came for the whole thing, for every module, every session. And at the end, they said, thank you very much. Now I know what Buddhism is. I can actually integrate it into my own belief system. I'm really grateful, but I'm going back to where I came from, which in Switzerland is Christianity. Fine. It's perfect. We're definitely not here to make you Buddhists or to convert you that you have to, you know, that you have to become Buddhists. So I'm very happy to be able to give you something that could be helpful. If it's not helpful, I really hope that it won't be harmful. So, you know, if it's not helpful, well, what can I do? But at least not be harmful. So to finish this evening, then tomorrow we kind of talk about what covers that beautiful, loving heart that we all have, that is our nature. We start talking about this. We will look at what is called the four immeasurable thoughts or attitudes, which is love, compassion, joy, and equanimity. Okay, and they can be these attitudes can be developed, but we have to recognize first what they are not, and also what it looks like sometimes it could be, but what it is not. So it's called the near enemy, and then the antagonist, what is not. So it's very good to see, because sometimes they masquerade as something like compassion and pity. Yeah, it's not the same thing. So this is what we're going to look at. And I started to call these four attitudes as immune system for the mind. Because when they are operating, like aggression, anger, sick desire, you know, we will talk about this. Don't throw all desires out of the window. Desire has good sides. So we need to see them, and then it's a little bit with this, and then bring love into the desire. Yeah. But this drive to be happy, the desire to be happy, it has also good sides. So we will be looking at that. Aggression has good sides, believe it or not, but not when we live it out. So again, we'll look at these things. How to, because all of this is just energy. So if you can strip it of this fixation of I, me, and permanence, then the energy can be very, very, very helpful in a way. Okay, yeah?
I think we don't really understand, or maybe don't really agree with throwing them out of the window. out of the window.
Throwing whom out of the window?
All those negative...
No, we need to recognize them.
I think it's very important to make a dialogue with them, because it's part of...
Of course. This is what we're going to... This is what I'm saying, because sometimes when people here have to be ethical, have to be loving, then they start to hate these parts of themselves. And then this is what I said. Then it becomes worse, actually. Mm-hmm. Yeah? So we need to recognize them. But we do want to strip them of their negative sides, of their exaggerated side, of that fixation. This is what we want to do. Yeah? Is that clear?
I think that the danger that it will become split, that it's bad. We want to throw them. People can make denial. And
yeah, but this is why you need to study it. This is why we're here. So these people who then go into denial, they're not here. So, you know, so what can we do about them? We cannot do about them anything. But this is why you're having discussion groups. This is why we discuss this. This is why you study it. Okay? But we're also not saying kleshas are leading to happiness. They have consequences. They lead to suffering. This is what we have to recognize. Yeah. But I think I started by saying you have to make a promise to yourself that you will be gentle with yourself by looking at them, not to identify with them. Is that clear?
Mm-hmm.
Or not so much? But the goal is to, again, we will... Define, you know, we can't, I will give you a definition. When we talk about anger, what we mean by anger? Anger has an attitude of a wish to harm. That is anger. When we talk about anger, we mean only that, not the frustration when your needs are not getting fulfilled or something like that. Anyway, we'll talk about this. Yeah. But the goal is to get rid of the kleshas, because they distort, because they exaggerate. And because when we have one of the kleshas in the mind, the energy becomes so strong that we forget about the happiness of the other person. That is what is dangerous. And we can recognize them when somebody else is angry at me. When I'm angry at somebody else, I don't see it. But when somebody's angry at me, then I can see the arrow that is in it, the wish to harm. This is why people feel hurt. Yeah? Okay? This is why I also said we will try to see in what way we can use desire or the strong energy of aggression. This is what I'm saying. Okay? So we'll finish the evening, then I'll let you go to bed, because I see that it's 9:15 already. I will finish the evening by the sutra, the Buddha's teaching on loving kindness. It's quite short. There's another thing that I can also send to you if I don't forget. It's a sutra from the Theravadin tradition, okay? But I really like it because it's short and it's really to the point. So basically the Buddha is talking to somebody who wants to generate a good heart, who wants to be kind. He's not talking to somebody who wants to be aggressive. Okay? So then he says, this is what should be done by one who is skilled in goodness and who knows the path of peace. Let them be able and upright, straightforward and gentle in speech, humble and not conceited, contented and easily satisfied, unburdened with duties and frugal in their ways, peaceful and calm and wise and skillful, not proud and demanding in nature, let them not do the slightest thing that the wise would later reprove. Wishing in gladness and in safety, may all beings be at ease. Whatever living beings there may be, whether they are weak or strong, omitting none, the great or the mighty, medium, short or small, the seen and the unseen, those living near and far away, those born and to be born, may all beings be at ease, let none deceive another or despise any being in any state. Let none through anger or ill will wish harm upon another, even as a mother protects with her life her child, her only child, so with the boundless heart should one cherish all living beings, radiating kindness over the entire world, spreading upwards to the skies and downwards to the depths, outwards and unbounded, freed from hatred and ill will, whether standing or walking, seated or lying down, free from drowsiness, one should sustain this recollection. This is said to be the sublime abiding. By not holding to fixed views, the pure-hearted one, having clarity of vision, being freed from all sense desires, is not born again into this world. Like here they talk about samsara, this compulsive being reborn again and again and again and again, pushed by our kleshas. So that's the Buddha's teaching on loving kindness. Okay, so I think we finished this evening. So silence starts now. Is that so?
When we go to bed.
Huh?
When we go to bed.
When you go to bed. Okay. There's another group here. Do you know where the hall is? Is it up there? So definitely this evening, when you go to bed, go like I don't know how long they are going on. It's Tova now. So they're much better with keeping silence than we are. So please make an effort. I already talked to them because I know Stephen. I don't know him. I met him once. So please, be considerate about them. So, because if you disturb their peace.